Alright, this is no good.
What?
Alright, you gotta do like a... pretend like you're listening to the YMCA.
No.
Come on, we gotta have the douchey thumbnail.
No.
Yeah, yeah.
No, no.
This is the only reason I need you.
No.
Lucas will do it.
Lucas.
Come on, you were almost there. Even though you were just pretending. Alright, that's good enough, but I think the wind's gonna ruin it because it's blowing over my camera and I'm sure it's blowing out the audio.
One of my dogs on a one dog mission to rid our yard of moles and chipmunks and everything else that's burrowing into it. Go ahead, pup. Don't worry. Dig up the whole yard. Nobody cares. Hope you can pay my medical bills and I break my leg.
Max, I just filled this hole 12 hours ago, pup. You don't care?
Alright, enough of that nonsense. You guys want to see my new shop? Let's go take a look. I apologize for the wind noise. It never stops blowing here.
Well, here it is. Max is certainly enjoying it. The building itself is 80 feet long, 42 feet wide, and 16 feet to the eaves. It has one overhead door. That door is 22 feet wide and 14 feet tall. So it's shingles on the roof. I believe it's a 312 pitch, and this is not a pole building, even though it has metal siding. This, I believe, is a stick-built building on top of a kind of a hybrid slab foundation setup. We'll talk about that more in a minute. Anyway, there's a house over there, and the whole works here sits on about 2 acres.
Well, like my last shop tour video, I think I'll start with my most frequently asked questions. And if you recall, in that last shop tour video, I casually mentioned that I might sell this Quincy 325 air compressor to the new inhabitants of my shop. And if you left a comment on that video, most likely that comment was to tell me to keep this compressor. And as you can see, I have kept it and it made the trip up here. So the only problem that I've ever really had with this air compressor is this side cover on the crankcase. You know, this is your oil sump right here, and what happens is there's too much distance between these bolts and it's just a thin aluminum cover. And I've tried a regular gasket, the fiber gasket material. I've tried a regular gasket with high tech. I've tried a regular gasket with silicone. I've tried a cork gasket. I've tried a cork gasket with high tech, and all of those have leaked a little bit right down here. So this time what I did is I took it off, I straightened the cover as well as I could between the bolt holes, and then I used a product called the Right Stuff, which is made by Permatex. It's basically just a silicone. Anyway, I put that on, set the cover in place just with the bolts finger tight, then I torqued them down 2 hours later, and then I waited 24 hours before I put oil in it, and cross our fingers, it's gonna hold this time. Now I believe that Quincy actually sells an upgraded cover that has a rib cast around the outside of this that's supposed to eliminate that problem. If I cannot get this thing to seal, then I'll probably investigate buying one of those. So the other thing I had to do was replace the motor, and originally it had a 3-phase motor. I have replaced the entire motor and starter unit with this General Electric single phase unit. Bought this off of eBay. It's old, but it's not been used. It came off of an old M-Glow air compressor that was converted to a gas engine. And what's nice about it is that it has this control box right here, which inside the control box, you can probably open it, the power is turned off, but inside the control box is an actual contactor and a thermal overload. Anyway, this is a lot more robust control than what they use on the, the cheaper kind of big box store type of air compressors where it'll have the little thermal overload button built into the, usually it's built into the housing for the start capacitors. and then they run the full amperage through the start through the pressure switch. I don't like that. I like having the actual contactor. Plus, by having the contactor, you can use a low amperage, you know, switch like this to control things. So I could actually remote mount this switch, you know, all the way across the shop if I wanted to control the air compressor without having to have a big, you know, disconnect switch. So this will give you kind of a good overview of the shop. And it does have these radiant tube heaters. I've never used this type of heater before, so I don't know how well it's going to work. I guess we'll find out. It actually has two of them, one on either side. Got a lot of stuff. It does have a floor drain here too. Alright, let's take a look inside. And I apologize, the place is a mess, but I just haven't had time to get everything unpacked and sorted out and put away, so most of my stuff's still sitting in boxes. And I gotta tell you, I have a lot of stuff. I had no idea how much stuff I had until I had to move it all. So everything in the boxes is pretty much things that were on shelves or in cabinets that had to be cleared out to move. So anyway, the floor concrete here, it's about 6 inches. I don't know if it's reinforced. I think it probably just has wire in it. This building was originally built for an excavating company. So they parked, you know, trucks and bulldozers and stuff like that in here. And then I believe at some point they finished it out and were turning it into a shop, but then the guy ended up selling it and building another shop closer to town. So I don't know exactly the story with that, but anyway, the inside here is all finished with OSB plywood on the walls, and then it's been painted white. And this is really the only corner that's basically done. I went ahead and assembled my steel rack, and you can see I repainted the white, and then I did gray down here at the first 4 feet. And I'm gonna try to do the whole shop in that same color scheme. I don't like having the white, it's just too much white. And then, you know, the white's always gonna look dirty down where you're working. So I think the gray is a better choice. Anyway, the steel rack's basically the same as my old shop. The only difference is if you recall, I will link to my old shop tour video. I don't know if it's in there or not, but there was a backside. These arms that stick out the front, it also stuck out the backside. And I ended up just cutting the bottom of the legs off so I could tuck it right up against the wall. I never really used the backside. You can't really use it unless you have the steel rack sitting out in the middle of the floor. And I just think it takes up too much space when you do that. So this will be better. But I think the rack's 20 feet long, so I can store 24 foot long bars without any issue. And at some point, the bandsaw is gonna live over here in this area. And then I'll have to come up with something to do with my sheet steel. I don't really have a good solution there. I may make a vertical rack over here at the end of the regular steel rack or something. Anyway, the old Clark forklift made the trip. Couldn't have done it without it. That thing is a lifesaver. If you guys are wondering, you know, like what machine you should buy first if you're thinking about starting a shop, my vote is a forklift. She's developed another big oil leak. Surprise, surprise. I know forklifts are basically just a four-wheeled oil leak, but now the transmission's starting to leak. I think, I'm not sure, but I think it's just the pan on the bottom of the transaxle that's leaking, so maybe we'll make a video about that. Engine lathe, some shelves, and the old drill press. That's in my old Victoria drill press, and then my press, and then my hydraulic press and welding table and stuff back there. Everything's just kind of stuffed in here for right now. This used to be my electronics workstation. And then I have these steel tubs that are just chock full of miscellaneous stuff. There's some shelving over there. The bandsaw, we'll talk about that later. More stuff. Workbench, the Lagoon knee mill, a couple of straight edges. Anybody need some class 4 forklift forks? I just happen to have a set. That's a homemade line boring machine. Maybe we'll talk about that in a future video. Some valve grinding stuff. This is a Sonnen connecting rod pin hone, or I also have some stuff for honing kingpin bushings with it. So back here in this back corner of the shop, they built an office on top of a storage area or an alcove. I think we're probably gonna take this down and salvage the materials from it. I don't like the way it was built or the location, it's kind of shoddy. And then, you know, it's all the way at the back of the shop, so the nearest entrance to that office is all the way over here at the opposite corner of the shop. So I believe we're gonna take this all down, so that eventually will be replaced with, you know, whatever needs to be in that area. For now, I'm just storing some stuff underneath the office area. So that's an old couch that used to be at my old shop. I have the gantry crane all assembled. That's a Thurn 4,000 pound gantry crane. It's a factory made item. I bought it from an air conditioning company, and they used to take it apart and move it to job sites and put it together to move large air conditioning units. Fantastic. I hear you, pup. So back in this corner, I have the two-post lift assembled, installed, wired up, and ready to go. It's basically the only thing I have that's really ready to go. That's a big transformer. If anybody needs a 38 kVA transformer, let me know. That one's available. There's a bench back here that was, I don't know, built by whoever built the shop. It's not a bad little workbench. I'm not certain it's gonna stay here, but I probably will keep it. Maybe we'll make a new top for it. I went ahead and broke down and bought my own rotary hammer. Got this old Hitachi unit. I bought this and like five basically brand new bits for less than what I would spend to rent one. So that was a no-brainer. Anyway, I used it to install the lift. And this concrete is so much stronger and better than the concrete at my old shop. When I installed the lift at my old shop, it was pretty sketchy. I tightened up some of these redhead concrete anchors, and I didn't think I was ever going to get them to actually seat and tighten up. The concrete was just so porous that they pulled up, you know, well beyond where I felt comfortable before they actually tightened up. Not a problem here. So for now, I'm just storing some miscellaneous stuff underneath the office. There's a solvent tank, parts washer, and a little blast cabinet. It's a Harbor Freight one. Don't buy it. It works really good at leaking sand all over the floor. That's about it. And then all my hardware and stuff is in cabinets in here, and it's really unhandy. I have to kind of scrounge through and move things around to get nuts and bolts and electrical terminals and stuff, so that's going to be one of the first things I get sorted out. And then this cool old Blackhawk jack. So my old Miller 330 ABP made the trip, and that's a tooling cabinet. This is an old Hotsea hot water pressure washer that I used to have in my old shop, and it's single phase, so it can go pretty much anywhere in the shop. That's an old Craftsman 110 volt oilless air compressor. That's like my backup torch. And then the old toolbox, the Masterforce. We did have a little bit of a catastrophe with the Masterforce toolbox, so I'm rethinking my endorsement of this. What happened, I don't know if you'll be able to see it on the camera, but basically I had this top drawer, which you can see is chock full, but I think still well within the weight rating of these drawers. Anyway, it was sitting on the back of the rollback truck, and it bounced its way up here. It's about 2 hours from my old shop to my new shop. And what happened is this back wall of the drawer actually buckled in the middle, and the whole bottom of the top drawer basically sagged down. So I had to take everything out of the drawer and then try my best to straighten that back panel, and then reach up from the bottom and straighten the bottom. And I got it to where I'm happy with it, but it will never be exactly the way that it was. So yeah, I guess it's partly my fault. The drawer's, I'm sure, overloaded, and it wasn't designed to be bounced around like that while it was loaded. But also, I don't think that would have happened if they had built the drawer a little bit differently. They should have, what they should have done is bent a lip over on the top of this back panel. Instead, they just hemmed it over and it wasn't strong enough. Anyway, that was really the only problem that I had moving my stuff. Everything seemed to make it okay. I did lose a part of the cross bracing for the steel rack, but believe it or not, I actually found it. I went back the next day and found the piece laying on the side of the road right where it fell off the truck. So that was pretty lucky and didn't hurt anybody. Now in this corner of the shop, there's a small kind of bathroom slash utility room that they built. And I believe that was the first thing that was built in the building before all the walls were finished. So everything's kind of tied together. Anyway, the breaker box and everything is inside there. There's a pump. We're on a sand point here, sand point well. So all that stuff is in that little room. But my plan probably is to demo that room and then salvage the materials from the upstairs office to build basically an office in this section of the shop. So we'll come off the corner of the window here, come out about 8 feet, and then go straight over to where those ladders are. And it'll be a utility room for the air compressor and the pump, a small bathroom, and then an office over on this side. Be about a, I don't know, 20 by 8 office, maybe with a little waiting room and stuff. And that bench right there will have to be removed, but we'll keep the door in the location where it's at. Well, I guess that concludes the nickel tour, but let's talk about some pros and cons with this building. So the biggest pro is that the building is already built. It's a nice size and it's more or less ready to go. Obviously there's things I want to do, but the building is totally usable the way that it is right now. And the roof is dry, the walls are insulated, maybe not perfectly insulated, but the place is pretty tight and pretty dry, and there's no reason that I can't just get to work. So another nice thing about this location, we're on a main state highway. So this road does not have seasonal weight restrictions. A lot of rural roads in this area have a seasonal weight restriction. They call it a frost law. Basically, when the frost is going out or, you know, melting, they'll reduce the statutory weight limit for the roads. And a lot of times you can only carry about half of the normal weight limit on those roads. And this road's also pretty heavily trafficked. So if I'm looking for, you know, drive-by type customers, I think there's a good chance you'll get them here. So another big plus is that this building seems to be pretty well built. Everything is straight. There is insulation in the walls. I'm assuming that there's insulation in the ceiling. It has a nice, well-poured floor. It's pretty level. There's a little bit of a hump here in the middle of the floor, just off the floor drain. But other than that, it's not cracked too bad outside of the cuts that they put in the floor when they poured it. So that's a good thing. And like I said, I don't think this is a pole building. I believe it's actually stick built. So I think the way that this building was built is that they dug a foundation wall in the ground without forms and poured basically the foundation wall like you would pour a footing. And then they just poured a slab of concrete over the top of that and tied it into the foundation wall with some rebar. And then the rest of the building is stick built on top of that slab. That's a fairly common commercial building technique in this area. I don't know if it's good or bad, but that's how they do it. It's cheaper than setting up forms to form an actual foundation wall, but you still get, you know, most of the benefits as far as frost heaving and stuff goes. So a major, major negative here is that we do not have three-phase power. That's the incoming power for my lot right there. And there's three wires, but there's only one phase. So another major negative with this building is the way they did the electrical. This is the main breaker panel right here. So it's 200 amp single phase breaker panel. This is a Square D home line series. So these are the cheap type of breaker boxes. This is probably my least favorite type of Square D breaker box. What I had in my old shop was a QO style with the Visitrip breakers. And then even better than that is the QOBs with the Bolton style breakers. But anyway, we can work with this. The problem is that they flush mounted the breaker box, so it's set into the wall like what you would do in a house. And then all the outlets and lights and stuff are wired up with Romex cable. inside the walls. So if you want to change anything or do anything, you're basically screwed. And I have to be able to get conduit in and out of here, so the only thing I could come up with was to use one of my wiring troughs, and then I just put a big elbow at the top of the box and connected it up to that trough, and then I can run my conduit out through the top of that trough. I already had that stuff, so I don't think it's going to be the end of the world, but if you're building a commercial building, I strongly encourage you not to run the wires inside the walls. You know, it's not that hard to do conduit, and then, you know, you can always upgrade and change the system later. You're not stuck behind, you know, behind a finished wall.
Now, one major negative is the lighting. This is all the lighting that I have in this shop right now. So there's just a row of 8-foot fluorescent lights right down the center, and that's it. The ceiling fans don't have lights on them, and they don't even work. So I more or less have to start over as far as the lighting goes, because as soon as the doors are shut, it's going to be like a cave in here. Another problem is that, like a lot of rural locations in the U.S., it's very hard to get reliable high-speed internet. This is actually how we get our internet here. It's a WISP, or a point-to-point wireless internet system. So that's a satellite receiver on our house. And then, I don't know if you can see it, but right on above that building, back behind it, is a tower. And there's a transmitter on that tower, and that's how we receive our internet. It's a point-to-point communication, so we have to have a line of sight to that tower in order for it to work. So obviously if there's any kind of overcast conditions or snow, then our internet's going to suffer. So one other issue I have has to do with the zoning. So we're not inside the city limits here, but we do have county zoning, and this property is zoned agricultural. And you get quite a bit of leeway as far as running a business from an ag-zoned property. I can actually do pretty much anything I want, but technically I'm supposed to have a special use permit, and I kind of investigated that. It seems like the process to get the special use permit is pretty much the same as the process just to change the zoning. So I think we're going to go ahead and proceed with trying to get the property rezoned to something commercial or industrial, and I don't think it'll be a problem. Like I said, I grew up in this county, and I know how the enforcement is, so even if we don't get it, I don't think it's going to be a problem. But that is one little hiccup. Technically speaking, we're supposed to be zoned commercial in order to do what we want to do here.
All right, guys, I think that's it. Thanks for stopping by. And I'm very excited about the new shop. I can't wait to get going in here. And, you know, my excitement level is here, but also my anxiety level is here, or maybe even above it. This is a lot of money. I spent every nickel that I had and a lot of nickels that I didn't have, and the move took a lot out of us. I started moving stuff basically in the middle of June, and it's almost the middle of September. I really haven't done any paying work in the last 2 months. All I've done is fix up our old house so we could sell it and try to get things going here at the new place. So, you know, I wasn't really able to take any of my customers with me, so I'm almost starting completely from scratch as far as my business goes. So we're going to have to see how that goes. I'm getting a little bit nervous. Luckily I had some money in, you know, saved up for this occasion, but it goes very quickly. So we'll take a deep breath, and hopefully everything's going to pan out for us. And also the YouTube channel is really taking off. I'm excited about that too. We're getting real close to 10,000 subscribers. And everything on the channel seems to be up, despite me not really being very diligent about uploading videos or really doing anything that I'm supposed to do as far as interactions with you guys. I've just been too busy. So we're going to start cranking out some videos. I got a whole backlog of stuff that we need to do. There's going to be a follow-up video on the Toyota 2AZ oil burning issue. There's going to be a couple follow-up videos about my 7.3 Powerstroke. We fixed some oil leaks, and I'll show you the ones that work and the ones that didn't work. And yeah, there's some other stuff in the pipeline. I'm sure now that fall is here, things are going to slow down, so we'll have more time to work on the channel. And I think if we can get to 10,000, we can really make something out of this. I know that's kind of a tipping point from what I've seen. Like, if you guys watch JC Smith Projects, he got 10,000 subscribers back at the beginning of the summer, I think in June sometime. And he's almost up to 20,000 now. He may be over 20,000. I haven't looked recently, but that's pretty amazing to double your subscribers, especially in the summertime when it's usually the lowest time for YouTube views. So, yeah, I think we can do it. So anyway, I'll see you guys on the next one.
Don't touch, please. It's coming. You need to move your hand. Step back, please. Step back.
Have a wonderful day.
Step back.
It's
yeah, but we don't want it to hurt us. Here it comes. Oh, really?
Yeah, getting the kinks out of them.
It's like it's running pretty smooth right now. Science. Okay, stay here. Don't touch. Thank you. stay back.